because one is over-influenced with logical, rational thought or scientific rationalism, right? And these things start influencing their judgment on the Quran itself. So I did want to bring this to your attention. And again, in a more thorough, systematic fashion, we will be dealing with this problem because it is an existing intellectual problem that Muslims are in fact suffering from. Anyhow, let's get to the surah, the final surah of the series, Surah An-Nas. And the first thing we'll talk about is its fundamental relationship between the surah itself and the surah that came before it. The previous surah ends, وَمِن شَرِّ حَاسِدٍ إِذَا حَسَدٍ. Last thing Allah says in Surah Al-Falaq, from the evil, from the harm of the one who is jealous, who has hasad, when he acts out in accordance with his hasad. Now you tell me, of all the creations of Allah, which creation is the most jealous? Which creation is the most jealous? The one who intends you the most harm? إِنَّهُ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ مُّبِينٌ. Iblis, shaitan. The next surah is dedicated to protect you from the one who is the most jealous, مِنْ شَرِّ الْوَسْوَاسِ الْخَنَّاسِ. Iblis himself, shaitan himself. So there's a logical progression. We asked in the end, from the protection from the harm of the one who has jealousy, and we get to the one who is the source of all of that jealousy. Even between human beings, when someone has jealousy, who inspires that jealousy in them? Who comes and puts waswasa in them to have that jealousy to begin with? So we identified the outwardly of the problem in Surah Al-Falaq, but the inwardly source, the ultimate source of that jealousy, Iblis himself, who comes and puts waswasa and says, why is that guy coming up? You need to do something about it. You need to say something. You need to plot something. That's been identified in Surah An-Nas. That's the first thing that connects these two surahs. Then of course we talked about how the Surah Al-Falaq is Allah Azza wa Jalla giving us protection from evils and harms that exist outside of ourselves. But Surah An-Nas, evils that make their way inside of ourselves, our own nafs, nas themselves, the whispers of people that enter into our hearts, shaitan, who is revolving in the chests of the people, inside of the people, fi sudurin nas. So evils on the outside are guarded against in Surah Al-Falaq, and evils on the inside in Surah An-Nas. Another way of looking at it also is, the evils mentioned in Surah Al-Falaq are out of your control. Somebody blowing over knots, casting spells over you, trying to harm you because of jealousy, these are things outside of your control. So you're asking Allah's protection from them. But if you look at Surah An-Nas, the things that Allah is talking about, people whispering and giving you suggestions and, you know, putting waswasa in you, whether or not you act on that waswasa, well, you will not be able to blame the one who whispered it to you. In other words, the liability in the previous surah is on the criminals who are engaged in the act of jealousy, engaged in the act of sorcery, engaged in the harm that they're trying to inflict on you in the darkness of the night. But in this surah, the responsibility will fall on who? Yourself. If you fall trapped to this waswasa, you will not be able to go to shaitan and say, it was your fault, you got me into this. It was your waswasa that made me go to this thing and do that thing or do the other thing, because on the day of judgment, he's going to say, لا تلوموني. Don't you blame me, no, blame yourself. I just sent the email, you're the one who clicked it. I just made the call, you're the one who picked it up. I just sent you the address, you're the one who drove there. I just gave you the invitation, that's all. The one acting on it was you, and you're in the end, you are the one that is responsible. So in this surah, the greater danger is mentioned, and one of the ways to look at it, once again, the evils mentioned in the previous surah, out of your control. And the evil mentioned in this surah, you are liable for yourself. You will have to answer for them yourself. Yet another way that it's been described by ulama, the relationship between these two, the previous harms, what is outwardly, meaning harms your dunya. The hasad can harm someone can harm you with their hasad in your dunya. Magic can harm someone psychologically and things like that. These are things that affect your dunya. But the waswasa of shaitan harms what? Your deen, your akhirah, your iman. So now we have to compare deen, dunya and deen, which is more precious, which has to be guarded more. You see, it's a very clear thing that our deen has to be guarded far more than our dunya. So we asked Allah's protection a lot more in Surah An-Nas. We only called on Allah once in Surah Al-Falaq. What did we say? قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِ رَبِّ الْفَلَقِ. Rabb came up once. Look at Surah An-Nas. We're asking Allah to protect our deen. How many times we call on Allah? قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِ رَبِّ النَّاسِ مَلِكِ النَّاسِ إِلَهِ النَّاسِ. Three times as much. We emphasized the protection of our deen, our iman, because when shaitan makes waswasa in your iman, putting doubts in it, putting jealousy in it, putting evil in it, putting greed in it, what is it attacking? It's attacking the faith, the taqwa. You know, the ihsan that one may possess, it can corrupt all of those things. So we ask Allah a lot more protection in this surah. And so here, like I mentioned, I mentioned this in Richardson, so I'll tell you again here. the one you're asking protection from is called al-musta'adhu bihi, al-musta'adh bihi. And the one who you are running from, the one you're trying to guard yourself from, the one you're trying to escape, al-musta'adh minhu. So you got two terms now, al-musta'adh bihi, the one you're seeking protection of. Al-musta'adh minhu, the one you're seeking protection from. There's a reciprocal relationship between this surah and the previous. The previous surah mentioned one musta'adh bihi, Rabbil Falaq. And then the rest of the surah was dedicated to several different instances of al-musta'adh minhu, meaning things you're running from, things you want to get away from. Min sharri ma khalaq, wa min sharri ghasiqin idha waqab, wa min sharri nafathati fil uqad, wa min sharri hasidin idha hasad. Several musta'adh minhu. Now it's been reversed in this surah. You have several musta'adh bihi. Qul a'udhu bi rabbin nas, malikin nas, ilahin nas. The mention of the one you're seeking protection from is far more. But shar, notice in the previous surah, how many times did shar come up? Min sharri ma khalaq, wa min sharri ghasiqin idha waqab, wa min sharri nafathati fil uqad, wa min sharri hasidin idha hasad. Shar, shar, shar. Multiple times shar. But here, multiple times rab. But how many times shar? How many musta'adh minhu? One, actually. Min sharri al-waswas al-khannas. And the rest of it is just an explanation of that ayah. If you look at alladhi yuwaswisu fi sudur al-nas min al-jinnati wal-nas, that is all an explanation of that central ayah of al-musta'adh minhu min sharri al-waswas al-khannas. So there's this reciprocity between these two surahs. Now, we get to the surah itself, we begin the surah itself, we say قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. The word قُلْ, I'm repeating from last time again. The placement of qul in this surah and the previous one has many powerful benefits. One, it's a when you recite it, when you recite this surah, you are already obeying Allah's command. Because qul is a command. And as an execution of that command, you are reciting this surah. In other words, one, before they're even entering into Allah's protection from evil, they're entering into Allah's obedience. And the lesson here is, you are not qualified to ask Allah's protection unless you are in Allah's obedience. If one is disobedient to Allah, they have no right to be asking Allah's protection. They need to come in Allah's obedience first. The second thing about